Well, hello, everyone. Welcome to Cross Lutheran Church on the second week of Pentecost. I'm Pastor Laurie, and Chelsea, Emily, and I are glad that you are worshiping with us today. If you're tuning in for the first time, it's good to have you with us. Our services will continue virtually throughout the summer, and we'll keep you advised of ongoing changes that are based on the ELCA guidance, the CDC guidelines, and Governor Walz's directives. This allows our planning teams to move through the phases of what it'll mean to reopen our sanctuary. It's important that we do keep everyone safe in the meantime. We'll keep you up to date with changes that occur. Your offerings may be sent in by mail, and we're so thankful for your consistency in that. If you know of someone who needs help, please call the church office and let us know. Emily would like to remind folks there's still time to fill out a music survey. You received an email with an access link, which can also be found in the June issue of the Cross Currents. And now we'll spend a moment or two preparing our hearts and our minds for worship. We begin our worship this morning on page 116 in your hymnals with a confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we've left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our opening hymn, Morning Cry, number 732.
Oh,
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the pray together the prayer of the day. Let us pray. God of compassion, you have opened the way for us and brought us to yourself. Pour your love into our hearts, that overflowing with joy, we may freely share the blessings of your realm and faithfully proclaim the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We continue with our readings.
A reading from Exodus. The Israelites had journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, You shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine. But you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites. So Moses came, summoned the elders of the people, and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." The word of the Lord. Joyful noise to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with a song. Know that the Lord is God, our Maker to whom we belong. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. Enter the gates of the Lord with thanksgiving and the courts with praise. Give thanks and bless God's holy name. Good indeed is the Lord, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from age to age. And the sheep of God's pasture. A reading from Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 9th chapter. Then Jesus went about with all to the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet as you leave that house or town. The Gospel of the Lord. Well, when I lived in Moline, Illinois, I used to walk a variety of routes, and one in particular took me to this huge parking lot of a church that was very close to my home. It was secluded and wooded, and I enjoyed walking the entire perimeter. And when I finished, I would head out onto the sidewalk, and the church right there had posted a small sign that read like this: be alert, be alert, you are now entering your mission field. And that sentence has stayed with me, as I've often seen it since. There was even one of those signs over the door of a church sanctuary where I recently served. And I sense it might be what Jesus is talking about in today's gospel. His message to the disciples that he's now sending out: how to be spiritually alert and to carry out God's mission. Jesus speaks of the harvest time now being ready. The crops, or people, if you will, are ripe for the picking. They're to take nothing with them but the clothes on their backs and to greet no one but the lost sheep of Israel. And what they are to say centers around peace. The idea of peace in the context that Jesus is speaking about is salvation and the saving of those who are going to hear his message. But I also think that it's good for us to remember that salvation also means healing. Not just of a physical sickness to be cured, but that healing or that wholeness that can only come from Jesus Christ. The revelation of a God who loves all people and seeks all people's healing. Not just the 12, not just you and me, but all God's children of every size, every shape, every sex, and every color. And if those who are present to receive this message, if they're worthy, and we need to be careful here too, because worthy in this particular sense means acceptance. So in other words, if those listening accept the message, they have it. They have it. And if they don't, it comes back to the disciples to share with other people. And if you think of this in terms of our own salvation that's given us in Jesus Christ, this is certainly then news worthy of sharing, right? Because the disciples have now been given salvation, and they've been commissioned to offer it to others and to still carry that gift inside of them no matter what, so it can be shared with others over and over and over. On the other side of that, we know then that free will comes into play, a reality as to who would respond to the message or not. It was simply their choice to do so. And from the sounds of this text we just heard, the disciples are not to stick around to see the results, whether the message is received or not, or whether to pass judgment or not. Because Christ's emphasis is on the proclamation. It's on the proclamation and the importance and the timeliness of it, rather than what might get in the way of what's being proclaimed. It's up to the people. It's up to the people to listen or to welcome that peace or not. The dust that Jesus speaks of a particular town that doesn't listen or accept the message, the dust that clings to the people's feet in that place is to be shaken off. And this might not seem like much to us, but it was really a deep insult in Jesus' day, because it was in effect saying they wanted no further contact with those people who would not listen. They didn't even want what was found on the bottom of their sandals or their feet to touch what had touched those non-listeners. It was best to shake it off instead. So it was a way of denouncing them. And this dusting off of the feet was important both in its action and in its symbolism. And the more I thought about this particular image, it struck me as being like the condition of sin. We sin because we choose to. We can hear the message that Christ proclaims or not. We can welcome or we can listen to it, or we can simply shake that message off as well, in denouncing the Holy Spirit or turning our backs on Jesus' call for us to love God and our neighbor as self, as well as to allow people or things to separate God from us. That's sin. So what dust, here's a good question, what dust needs to be shaken from our feet so we might move deeper into relationship with Christ to become more like him? It could be anger, or mistrust, fear, hard-headedness, or even hard-heartedness. All those things can separate us from God. We might be jealous of someone or something, or needing to let go of something that is literally crippling us from the freedom of what it means to live in a loving relationship with Christ and others. It might be that thing that keeps us up at night, worrying and fretting so much that it only makes matters worse. It might be our own prejudices or biases, our tendency to see people as other, whether it's along party lines or color or sexuality or religion. You fill in the blank, because we all have plenty of dust to shake off our feet if we are to see God, to see God and all God's people as worthy of God's mission field, worthy of listening to and sharing with. And it's only through Christ dying and being resurrected that we remember those gifts of forgiveness and salvation, which has been given freely to us through Jesus. And so Jesus Christ continues to call on us and to call on others to continue to proclaim and to live out the message of his good news. And there's reconciliation and peace to be found in that. That's very intriguing to me, because what it says to me is that it tells me that Jesus may be placing just as much emphasis on the call of the disciple as he is on those who are going to hear the proclamation. Jesus said it himself. He said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." So no matter what, the disciples were to keep on keeping on with a message of peace and salvation, which leads to healing and wholeness, not only today, but for all, eternity. And we know that Christ would proclaim the kingdom as well, go places where the disciples went, never asking them to do anything that he wouldn't do himself. So Jesus called the 12, and Jesus calls us to help pave that road to salvation, to peace, to reconciliation, and to healing. The words that were given to the disciples by Christ is our call today, too, because the message is timeless. The message is timeless, and as disciples, then, we're called. We're called to shake that dust off our feet, to denounce all that is, all that would come between us, and the proclamation of the kingdom. Sin and all that would separate us from our message, our relationship with God, our neighbor, and God's plan and purpose for our participation in it is to be shaken off as insult to what God has in store for us and all of creation. We proclaim the good news directly or indirectly, with intentional and unintentional words and actions. Because people either see Christ in us or they don't, depending on whether or not we use his words and examples or model it. And you know what? We're not always going to see the effects of our message. It could be proclaimed without us even knowing it, yet we've proclaimed it nonetheless. And it does make a difference. My daughter Abby and her husband Barry and my two grandsons, Liam and Soren, live less than a mile from where George Floyd was killed. So on the day of his memorial in Minneapolis, I walked down with them and others in their neighborhood to 48th and Chicago, where we all took a knee in silence for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. There were more than a few of us, but what struck me the most was the number of people. In addition to that, was the various ages of them all. All of my daughter's friends who walked with us brought their children, from 3 years old to a bunch of teenagers. And they took a knee, too. They took a knee, too. They were masked, and they were quiet, modeling their parents as they practiced healing and compassion in a peace-filled way. And the silence was palpable. Even from those people who stopped to watch what was happening, people came out from the stores and the shops that were around that area, and some of them took a knee too. This is what gives me hope in our call to share the good news, even when it doesn't seem like good news, because people can choose to accept it or not. And Christ could have called on his authority and also God's authority to easily do what the 12 he had called were doing without their help, without our help at all. But that's not what Christ is about. Jesus Christ is about relationships, that growing of us as God's children to God. To know and to grow in our relationship with God, and then to share that relationship with others. By shaking the dust off of our feet, we proclaim the urgency of this good news with hope, with love, with peace, compassion, all in what we say and do. Hafsat Abiola is a Nigerian human rights, civil rights, and democracy activist. She's founder of the Kudirat Initiative for Democracy, which seeks to strengthen civil society and promote democracy in Nigeria. I like what she says about peace. She says this: peace comes from being able to contribute the best that we have and all that we are toward creating a world that supports everyone. But it is also, she says, securing the space for others to contribute the best that they have and all that they are. In other words, in Jesus' words, it is to extend. It is to extend God's peace for all those who will listen and accept it, to a mission field that is really all around us, too good not to share with others. And there's always room then. There's always room then for others to join and to share the mission too. We celebrate. We celebrate and share the good news. It's received, or we shake the dust off our feet and then continue to share it. So the kingdom is at hand. What's under our feet? Amen. With the whole church, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, we pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Gracious God, you call your church through the waters of baptism. Give courage to those who lead us through word and sacrament, witness, service, and song. Strengthen all the baptized for lives of service in Christ's name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You nourish the waters of creation. We pray for oceans and rivers, streams, and our lakes of Minnesota. Grant us wisdom as we care for these life-giving waters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You pilot the nations, and we ask your help in the divisions we've created that you will not own. Direct all leaders in the daily tasks of listening and speaking, and empower them to develop lasting avenues for peace and reconciliation. Protect citizens in Israel and Palestine, Syria, Central America, and the United States. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us not forget the name and person of George Floyd. Strip away pride, suspicion, and racism so that we may seek peace and justice in our communities. Strengthen our hearts so they beat to the rhythm of your holy will as we listen and learn from one another. Fill us with your light as we walk humbly toward a future filled with encounter and unity for people of every color. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You soothe our fearful hearts. Comfort those who grieve, those who are lost, those who doubt, and those who are sick, especially those named in our hearts or aloud before you. Mariah, Ron, Joan, Dottie, Richard, Marv, Sharon, Lee, Kennedy, Sarah, David, Kareen, and Keith. Give faith in the midst of all that troubles your people, and give wisdom and clarity to those researching medicine and vaccines for the coronavirus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up the saints who have gone before us, Phyllis Rigwalski, Pat Hagen, Daryl Anderson, Carol Lindquist, Richard Agnew, David Larson, Ellie Wissman, Bruce Berggren, Leon Henriksen, Marlis Johnson, Claire Olson, Mike Long, and Arlo Stack. Sustain us in your mission until the day you bear us up to join all your saints in light for all eternity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those known only to you, through the power of your Spirit and in Jesus' most holy name. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our sending hymn, Go Make Disciples, number 540. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.